Behind me here is the Golden Fleece Yacht. We'll be joining them for 4 days as they travel around the islands, documenting and taking rare glimpses of some of the islands that others might not have seen before.
Seven of us boarded the Golden Fleece, ready to depart on an exciting voyage to the untouched corners of the Falklands. The group predominantly comprised of members from the Shallow Marine Surveys Group, a collection of marine biologists and divers aiming to grasp a greater understanding of the biodiversity amongst Falkland's marine life, as well as passengers looking for adventure. Sea lions dozed in the sun as we loaded the last of our belongings aboard for what would be for many passengers the last they'd have for 2 weeks. Waving farewell to Stanley, the Golden Fleece sailed through the glistening water surrounding our familiar home, allowing for brief glimpses of the shoreline and some of the wildlife inhabiting the bay on our doorstep. The crew, skippered by the world-renowned sailor Jerôme Poncet, unraveled the sails and kick-started the boat's engine, departing the calmer water surrounding Stanley. Passing the Cape Pembroke Lighthouse, we departed from the familiarity of Stanley's borders and pushed forward away from the Berkeley Sound. Bathing in the novelty of the sea air, we chased to the bow of the yacht to face the upcoming waves. As the sun set on Stanley, choppy waves descended upon the bobbing motor sailing yacht as we reached open water. Turbulent seas struck on the 60-mile journey to Bleecker Island. Jerôme Poncet has been sailing for 40 years, first taking to the seas with his close friend Gerard Janicon when they were 20 years old. In 1969, the pair departed on a 5-year voyage to circumnavigate both Arctic and Antarctic circles.
I still enjoy going in some place where I know nobody has been overseas. It's become a bit smaller, the little corner. When I sail to South Sandwich Island, I still find this the same feeling we had 40 years before. You know that you are with a small boat on water where nobody has been. Yeah, we are the first in the Antarctic, the first in different places. But for me, the first is important because it was in the idea of discovery. We arrive in place where nobody has been, at least on a farm, on a small boat, and everything was to be, well, not only discovering the place, but discovering the way to do it with a small boat, and for me it was adventure.
But away from the glamour of Jerôme's sailing fame, the Golden Fleece had a murky history. The yacht was previously owned by the Newell brothers, who killed their parents in 1987 and sailed away on the Golden Fleece to escape with their inheritance just short of £1 million. After several years on the run, including a brief stint in the Falklands, the Royal Navy intercepted the yacht and the pair were later charged for murder and conspiracy to cover up the killing of their parents. Miserable weather opened the second day of sailing. Birds frantically flapped through the air as we drew closer to Bleecker Island. As the yacht dropped its anchor, the biologists, divers, and volunteers for the Shallow Marine Surveys Group plunged into the chilly waters, ready for the first of multiple diving trips. Others of us jetted to Bleecker Island, an island intentionally recognised as a highly important conservation habitat for bird populations, known as an important bird area. The land hosts more than 49 species of birds, 37 of which are breeding species. There were more birds than the eye could count, and they took to the skies above us, rock cormorants swooping gracefully through the air in a whirring tornado of birds. Just a few hundred yards away, loud squawking echoed beyond the tussock grass. A vast colony of rockhoppers were unveiled on the surrounding cliff faces that enclosed Bleecker Island. Rockhopper chicks in the infancy huddled together. Having only been born 2 months previously in the November, the furry chicks awaited feeding from their parents and engaged in atypical family squabbles. busy new parents collected twigs, branches and clumps of vegetation to develop their nests for their ever-maturing chicks. In the distance, the Golden Fleece herald us back aboard the ship to return with the divers. The research group had resurged from their underwater exploration, bearing one of their samples which would then be studied further, a pod from the local squid, the Laligoli.
Well, this is one of the pods for the local squid, the Laligoli, or Dorotheus guy it's now called. In one of these pots there's about between 60 and 80 larvae, if I remember correctly. And when we were down there, well, how many pods were there in one of the in that bundle?
Oh,
I mean, I would say 30 or 40.
About
30 or 40. And so that was at about 15 meters, which is a typical depth for Laligo to deposit eggs. So. But we could see they were quite old, because you might see there's a little bit of brown residue on the outside, which presumably is algal growth. And so this is when we thought, well, there's probably quite an old pot, and that's why I thought bring some up. But you can see the larvae in there. I mean, they're about, well, I would say 6 millimeter long, perhaps. You could see the eyes, and I'm not sure if you can see that on the camera, but you can certainly see it.
So this is just almost like a shell, so a pod for all
these. Yeah, this is one pod, so the female actually spawns this in one go. But I suppose they might do 6 or 7 at a time.
As well as gathering samples, the divers collected some ocean delicacies for the crew to devour. Sea urchins, recovered from the ocean bed.
Caesar, get out, and what you eat is a sexual material, anyway, it's inside. Which is beautiful color normally. Some are yellow, some are brown. Better lemon.
Bit of garlic.
Beautiful. No garlic, really. Just lemon.
Jerôme checked his maps, plotting coordinates to continue the voyage. The waves lapped against our yacht as she darted into the distance, the sun setting on the first 2 days of our journey.
It was our third day of sailing through Falkland's waters, and an experience dissimilar from anything some of us had ever tried before. A playful scurry of dolphins accompanied the vessel's entry to Sandbar Island.
I'd never experienced what it was like to live for a period of time on a boat. I'd only been on a day trip, so I thought, it's quite an incredible way to see the islands from the water. I've been to Sea Lion and obviously walked over the land, but I haven't seen any of the islands from the sea. So, oh, it's incredible. I mean, the life you can see from here, it's amazing. Up close.
Sea lions and elephant seals lounged on the sandy shores before dashing into the sea. Departing on the Zodiac dinghy, we headed ashore to gain a closer look at the pinnipeds, which is the Latin translation for fin-footed.
As you can see behind me, there are sea lions as well as elephant seals on the beach grazing behind us. While we were travelling in on our dinghy, which was a Zodiac, quite small boat, all the sea lions started to run towards the shore.
That was quite scary in the water when they all approached us, but I think they're just more inquisitive than wanting to cause any trouble. They just want to know what's going on. Hopefully I'll get to see more.
Arching their heads upwards to catch the rays, the sea lions dozed while the elephant seals closely huddled together, flapping sand at one another. If they say the camera adds £10, then FITV mustn't have been the only film crew on the island capturing shots of these elephant seals in their natural habitat. stray Magellanic scurried into the tussock grass, hiding from the island's new visitors. The vast population of sea lions and elephant seals provided perfect up-close photograph opportunities.
What have been like the highlights for you?
Being so close to the sea lions, yeah. And realising you can get quite close and then they'll let you take photos of them, they'll pose for the shots, that was quite cool.
You just go to your cabin, maybe a pit, and ride the storm, and then when you wake up in the morning it's sunshiny. We've got elephant seals, turkey vultures, Magellanics, there's penguins, there's one just coming in, dolphin gulls, kelp gulls, great southern petrels, and best of all, sea lions.
Before long, it was time to return to the Golden Fleece, but holding up our return was a barricade of curious sea lion who had formed a temporary blockade between us and our faithful yacht.
I've walked up beside them before, and I know they can show aggression, and they've made several metres towards you, but they generally stop. And if, as long as you're light of foot, you can beat them. They're a bit clumsy, aren't they, on land. I wouldn't like to corner one. I wouldn't like to get one without an escape route, but they tend to back off. But it is awesome to see them. They're big animals.
That's a lovely spot.
That's awesome.
After an adventurous day basking with the elephant seals and sea lions of Sandbar Island, the Golden Fleece continued on to Port Albemarle for a dive at the Arch Islands. The Shallow Marine Surveys group were preparing for their next dive.
Are you not put off by the fact there's loads of sea lions over there?
There is a bull over there, so we might just need to be a little bit wary.
Yeah.
Despite the potentially threatening ocean dwellers who were playfully swimming in the waters, the researchers, readying themselves with final checks prior to their dive, leapt overboard and into the water. They set off to explore the underwater crevices and deep sea life under the sea. Taking advantage of the fresh fish in the ocean, Jerôme pulled up another crab pot.
A lobster crab.
Are they quite common or are they?
Yeah, very common here. There's probably thousands of them under the boat. We've got a bucket full here. But there'll be dinner.
And you can see them in the Stanley Harbour. They swarm up in the water column. You can see them swarming, and you'll see birds will be following their swarms around.
And then the whales feed on them.
Yeah.
Back aboard the ship, members of the Shallow Marine Surveys group shared some of their discoveries and the science behind their work.
The Falklands waters are relatively undiscovered in a sense, so there's still a lot of excitement for you guys as researchers.
There really is. There's a lot. Yeah. The biology of the place, the biodiversity of the place, hasn't really been well looked at. At all. The earliest was in the 1920s during the discovery expeditions, and nothing has really happened since then. And since the Shallow Marine Survey Group was formed in 2006, that's when we started looking at the inshore areas quite closely. But, you know, so many places in the Falklands are quite remote, so any time we get a new opportunity to come and explore a new area, it's usually the first time anyone's ever looked at it with a biodiversity sort of scientific perspective. So it's a great opportunity. Yeah. Being a marine scientist, I've always got these interesting questions going on in the back of my mind, I guess, and there's a few scientists here, so we'll have a look around and try to make, you know, good scientific benefit from the trip as well.
So that's his eyes over here, his tail.
So it's an amphipod. It's a little, commonly called a sandhopper. You see them on the beaches. Whenever you turn over a log or something, you'll see them scuttling around. So this is just another variety of that type of animal. Yeah. And this one lives on the back of starfish.
Yeah.
If you think you've got a new species, you've basically got to go and check out all the existing species that are similar, and then work out if it is different, do sort of anatomical comparisons and work it all out. And we've got, you know, specialists we'll talk to help us work out whether it is a new species or just, you know, an existing species that happens to be down here.
Yeah, were you just taking pictures of them, or were you trying to take some back to the lab?
No, we'll preserve whole specimens, so I think Paul's got some preservative with him, and then we'll preserve some whole specimens, take them back to the lab, you know, examine them under the microscope, work out if they're new species or something, just already exists. So it'll be, we think it's new, but we'll find out.
We'll send it to an expert. There'll be a specialist in amphipod taxonomy, and he'll confirm based on all of his knowledge if it's a new species or if it's a variant of a currently known species, or maybe a new record for the Falklands but it's been found elsewhere, that kind of thing. So anyway.
It's quite exciting for you, really.
Well, it's quite novel and interesting. It's something that we've noticed before. We've never really kind of fully explored it. So again, it's one of the little pieces of science that we can do while we're on this trip, which isn't too demanding and is also kind of fun at the same time. Fun for nerds, anyway. So this is his head, up here. It's a very bizarre animal, isn't it?
It's very unusual.
And that's an invasive species. And it's now found all over the world, originated in Europe. And it comes over, you know, attached on, he makes this long tube. It's called a parchment worm, commonly. You can see how that would attach onto the bottom of a hull of a ship. And next thing you know, you've got, you know, spread everywhere. So it's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, there it is there. So that's the worm.
Oh, yeah.
That's the Catopterous worm, polychaete. So we'll send him to a fellow called Jeff Reed in New Zealand, who's a expert, like a specialist in these types of worms. And so he's doing a study on the genetics of these animals to see if they are actually all one species all around the world, or perhaps maybe they're not. You don't know what you have at risk now at the moment. You can't understand the risks until you know what you have to be at risk. And so that's really where we are now, is still exploring, you know, what it is that we have in the Falklands. Once you better understand those basic things, we can then understand, well, what are the risks that other larger industries, such as oil industry or any other type of you know, potential impact we might have in the future, what the potential risk would be, given what we know about the habitats and species now.
Paul continued his research below deck, logging the group's findings from under the water. Leaving the Arch Islands after a hard day's diving, Jost Pompert shared his reasoning for coming aboard the Golden Fleece.
The diving is the best bit. Well, I mean, of course, it's nice to go ashore to these fantastic places, you know, desolate beaches that you never go to otherwise, so that is really cool, I think, you know, to see, like this morning, the elephant seals and the sea lions. And again here, I mean, you can see the background here where we dived, and of course they swam around us this afternoon, so yeah, I mean, it's a really nice thing to be able to have a holiday in the Falklands.
Definitely. I mean, it must have been incredible actually, like, swimming with the sea lions.
Yes, no, that is quite nice. They are very inquisitive, and they come and seek you out. Yesterday they were nibbling on both my fins and my buddy's fins, so that was quite funny. You know, they grab hold of it and they tug it in.
Sailing off into the sunset, we headed for Bird Island, one of the most remote locations for bird wildlife in the whole of the Falklands. Stay tuned for the penultimate installment from the Golden Fleece journey. One of the main allures purpose of the trip aboard the Golden Fleece was a chance to visit Bird Island, one of the most remote hotspots for such an eclectic collection of wildlife in the Falklands. Bird Island lies south of Port Stephens and Calmhead and is only accessible by boat. The vast array of bird life on the islands highlighted as an important bird area for BirdLife International are described by Ian Strange in the following sentence. Such offshore islands as Bird Island are the remaining strongholds of a large percentage of bird life. An uncountable swarm of seabirds are massed in the skies surrounding Bird Island, fitting the statistic from 1998 that there are more than 10,000 breeding pairs on the islands. This estimation has bound to have increased considerably in number. As we were escorted ashore on a cramped dinghy through the far-extending kelp forests, a jungle of underwater mazes. We bid a brief farewell to the Golden Fleece. Rockhoppers pedaled themselves through the water in eager swarms before catapulting themselves out of the sea and onto the rocky ledge. As we approached closer to our landing spot on Bird Island, the rockhoppers eyed us up, uncertain of the new visitors to their cut-off corner of the world.
We're jumping on here.
We crashed into the nearby rock formation, disturbing the rockhoppers who frantically dived for cover. Rockhopper by name, rockhopper by nature, the penguins stuck true to their name, frantically racing to rejoin their groups. Bird Island itself is roughly triangular in shape and consists of sheer cliffs reaching up to 110 metres high, tussock grass areas and a soft, thick peat which hold many of the abundance of wildlife that cohabit on the islands. Black-browed albatross are in great number in the islands, with there believed to be more than 10,200 breeding pairs in 1998. It was surreal to see so many bird species intermingling so fluidly and comfortably in such a small proximity to one another. The noise was spectacular. Countless birds squawking, stamping their authority on the islands.
This place is just thriving with wildlife, as you can probably hear behind me. There are birds flying past us even as we talk here. It's beautiful and equally one of the most difficult locations to reach in the Falklands. It's just off Port Stephens, but it's only accessible via boat as there are no landing strips anywhere nearby. This is an island consumed by animals, nothing else. There are no humans living here at all, so it is as natural as you can get for a wildlife habitat.
Overhead, the intrepid explorers continued to discover more just beyond the soft peat banks.
I'm going home, sit down and tell my mom. I'm going home, sit down and tell my mom. Cause there's no way for me to get along. They know them women mama, they treated you.
More than 10,000 individual South American fur seals dwell on the islands, and it would appear that their numbers are increasing even further. Some of the fur seals were particularly disturbed by our visit and scurried away to the violent swell of the sea, whereas others, not so timid, bounced closer. A small number of South American fur seals were lured closer to one of the Golden Fleece explorers, Kieran, who was but a hand's reach away from the cute young pups.
With the wildlife here, really, there's so much of it, it's just really important that you don't disturb it, and the best thing to do is really just sit down and be really quiet. And with things like fur seal pups, if you do that, they'll often approach you quite closely. And then the half an hour ago or so, the first few pups came right up to me. But they're not really scared, especially if you're very low. You're much less threatening to them, so they tend to approach you much more closely.
It's fascinating to watch as well. I mean, they're so confident kind of coming so close to you as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's quite interesting. The fur seals are a different species here compared to South Georgia, where I usually work. And they are much more timid. The ones that on South Georgia generally are a little bit more willing to come forward and interact with you.
Birds swarmed the clear cornflower blue skies. Among them were the caracara, who nested happily among the other breeds on Bird Island. A figure predicts that more than 50 breeding pairs reside under Bird Island, and it's considered to be one of the most important mating grounds for the species. And take me away from here. Friend, take me away from here. Nimble, light-footed Cobb's wren hopped around the rocks, making a worthy adversary for the hopeful photographers of our trip. Unlike the rock hoppers, who calmly posed for their next photo shoot.
What drew you aboard the Golden Fleece?
I've only been living in the Falklands for about 3 or 4 months, and I've been coming through for 15 years working for British Antarctic Survey and South Georgia Government. And I had not had the opportunity to get out west, and this is the best way to do it, I think. Jerôme has obviously got a colossal amount of experience, and it's a great boat, and the opportunity to mix doing some fantastic wildlife landings and also doing some diving, there's no better way to do it, I don't think. The Golden Fleece is ideal. All by myself, I cried alone by myself. I stood on a roadside and cried alone by myself. I stood on a roadside and cried alone by myself. And there's no way for me to get alone.
As we drifted back to our yacht, a nearby sea lion reared its head from the water. Momentarily, rockhoppers would appear above the water before pouncing down beneath the waves. Blink, and you could quite easily miss the penguins as they toppled out of the glistening ocean. Bird Island was truly spectacular in all ways imaginable. The bird life, the scenery so untouched and unspoilt by human hand. It seemed to be more fitting that Bird Island was the imagination of some author than a reality. There's no way for me to get alone. I want a train to come along and take me. Away from here, friend, take me away from here. Let the train come along and take me away from here. And that be no way for me to get alone. As we left the wonders of Bird Island behind, the final place of exploration for FITV, it seemed only fitting to hear more about the man who had been at sea for more than 40 years, acquiring accolades, ferrying the likes of David Attenborough, and collecting a host of anecdotes. The man behind the mast, captain of the Golden Fleece, Jerôme Poncet, told us about his life.
Quite a lot of years I've been sailing but everywhere, mainly in the south, and yeah, it's something you get with time. You start to be known because it's a long, long time you are sailing everywhere. Yeah, we are the first in the Antarctic, the first in different places. But for me, the first is important because it was in the idea of discovery. We arrive in place where nobody have been, at least on a farm, on a small boat, and everything was to be, not only discovering the place, but discovering the way to do it with a small boat. And for me, it was adventure. I still find this the same feeling we had 40 years before. You know that you are with a small boat on water where nobody have been ever. everything was a challenge or nothing was a challenge, I don't know. I've been sink on a boat by a killer whale, make a hole on the boat. That's when I was racing. It was a wooden boat, but you make a hole, a big hole, and the boat sink in 5 minutes.
That's terrifying. Were you not?
No, we had no time to be terrified until you find yourself in a life raft, but that's all.
A lot of quick thinking then.
You do, first thing, life raft, save a bit of water, food, whatever, and jump anything, and suddenly you realize, here I am. I'm drifting in the middle of the ocean. Yeah. We have been also in the past with my first boat upside down. We think we are going to die also. It was a small boat, big water. It's having some moment a bit dodgy.
Yeah.
And we get out. Oof.
We pulled into Beaver Island, the inland strip which Jerôme knows as home.
I spent about not very much on Beaver itself, on this island, about 4 months a year. That's all. On and off, some year five, some year three. It's an average. And I would like to spend a bit more now, try to slow down on a sailing side, but it's a bit difficult to change. Maybe I will success next year. We come out in the Falkland and passing through and find it a good place. We were completely living on a boat, but was starting to get some idea of getting a foot ashore, and we do it slowly. Yeah. 1 foot, 2 foot, and now since a lot of year, we spend about 6 months sailing and 6 months on land.
Beaver Island was almost as intriguing as Jerôme himself, with numerous reindeer antlers scattered for decorative effect. Reindeer were non-native to the island and was introduced between 2002 and 2003 from a translocation of South Georgian reindeer to Beaver Island. 31 of the species was moved from South Georgia via boat, and following that, the population has soared. In 2008, there was 107 of them. Since then, their numbers have swelled dramatically.
We know that one day the reindeer will disappear from South Georgia, and all of them want living on Beaver Island, so it's a good place for them, and fact is, it's a good place for them. And they multiply a lot, like rabbits, but at least I get what I was wanting, is access to this beautiful meat. Reindeer meat is, for me, is close to the perfect meat. Mm.
Jerôme predominantly sailed in the Southern Hemisphere, and in 1973 skippered the first small yacht to reach the Antarctic Peninsula and sail below the Antarctic Circle.
I just come back from the Antarctic a week ago, I was there or something, and I still love it. Yeah, a beautiful place. It's good weather too. It's a bit less wind than finally, less wind than in the Falkland. So far, I've been to the Antarctic every year since 40 years, I would say. So, and I cannot imagine a year without a trip there. It's small, it's very, very satisfying. That's why I do it, and that's why I like it.
The 4 days on the Golden Fleece vanished before my eyes, and in no time at all, our flight was landing, ready to return us to Stanley. 4 days aboard the glorious Golden Fleece, taking in indescribable sights and reaching locations we never could have imagined. From the rockhoppers of Bleecker to the sea lion of Sandbar, and most memorably, the vast wildlife on Bird Island. The trip was truly once in a lifetime.